days, we go deeper and we try to move by the Holy Spirit to bring to that place of fruitfulness into the school of ministry, and knowing what God can do with your life and how great our God is. We have great confidence in God. We have great confidence in what God has and what God has promised to do and what God has destined to do. So we have great confidence in the power of God. And that as you learn, you become equipped. You're not just a hearer only, but you're a doer of the word. As you begin to learn, you are being equipped so that you can effectively minister in the place where God has called you to minister. I told you we believe in ministry. We believe that God has equipped you somehow to minister, or God has equipped you somehow for ministry. You may say, well, Pastor Williams, I don't think. No, that is you. You don't think. And thank God, because you don't think. Because if you think, it would be a different thing. Now you get the gist. Because I don't think God, no, it's good that you don't think. Because you don't think, it's very good. Because you don't think, so it's very good. You are equipped, you're called to those to whom many is called. It is required that a man be found faithful to whom God has given much. Much is required of you. It's time you make use of it. All right. I haven't said that I love you and I welcome you to God's presence. And I know that God is going to do great things with your life today. Oh, Father, we give you praise. We magnify you. We love you. We love you, Father. We thank you. Thank you for your mercies. Thank you for your grace. Your compassion towards us is great. You've done great and mighty things for us. You've done awesome things with our lives. You've done wonderful things with our world. You've done awesome things with our destiny. So we're grateful. We're glad that we have you in our lives. We're so glad that you are Father, you are God, you are King, you are Mentor, you are everything, and everything there is who you are. Exodus chapter 28, verses 38 is our memory verse this morning. Our commentary is taking daily devotion is coming from that scripture. I read, the iniquity of the holy things. The iniquity of the holy things. I read, what a veil is lifted up by these words, and what a disclosure is made. It will be humbly and profitably for us to pause a while and see this sad sight. The iniquities of our public worship, its hypocrisy, formality, lukewarmness, irreverence, wandering of heart, and forgetfulness of God. What a full measure have we there. Our work for the Lord, its emulation, selfishness, carelessness. Now I want you to underline that word carelessness. I want you to really take note of that word carelessness seriously. We need to really understand that word very, very seriously. Carelessness. All right. Let me repeat it so you understand it. It's talking about Exodus 28:38. It talks about the iniquity of the holy things. Holy things that has become impure by us. Holy things that normally would have given God glory. But now God is not interested in these things. God is not excited by these things. God is not motivated by these things. But these ought to be holy things. These are things that were meant to be holy things. Now you need to understand, church, that God is a covenant God. God is a covenant God. God is not going to compromise his stance with you. God is a God of covenant. He keeps covenant for 1,000 generations, for eternity. That's his nature. That's who he is. Therefore, God cannot change. God don't go, oh, I forgot to do something here. Do I have to change this? No, God does not change. God cannot change. God will not change. So it's talking about if the veil is lifted by these words, what a disclosure is made. A disclosure is made what the intent of the purpose is revealed. It will be humbly and profitable for us to pause a while and see this sad sight. the iniquities of our public worship. How do you represent God in the public? That's what he's trying to explain there. It's hypocrisy when we come to church on Sunday. Or whatever day you have church. Formality. Lukewarmness. Lukewarmness. Even when you come on the conference call, are you conversant that God is with you? Or are you just joining? I got to join so the apostle will know I'm online. At least someone will know I'm online. Let me just dial in. Do you reverence God? Is there a reverence that I've died into this conference line because I want to encounter God? I want my life to be changed. I want my world to be transformed. I want to see God in a deeper and a meaningful way. I want to become more useful, a vessel of honor unto God. One of the pastors, our resident pastor in Fort Worth South, said something New Year's Day that give God, you heard Pastor Sandra on the line the other day, talked about it. Give God your best this year. We want to give God our best this year. No leftover. You're not giving God any leftover. You're giving God your very best this year. Your very best of your energy. Your very best of your resources. Your very best of your time. Your very best of your talent. Your very best of your finance. Your very best of your creativity. Your very best of your administration skills. Your very, you don't know we need them, right? Your very best of your character. Your very best of your dispositions. Your very best time. Oh, we could have put the prayer line 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 20, 11 o'clock in the afternoon and say, no, we give God our first fruit, so we're coming 4:30. At least 4:35, we're all getting ready to go in. It's all right. We give God our best fruit, 4:30, 5 o'clock, it's all good, same time frame. The first, you rise up early, you give God your best. That's why some folks have told us, why don't you start 8 o'clock in the morning to be better? No, 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 no. No, no, no. For 7 years plus now. October was 7 years. It has not changed. Basically, all my life I've grown up in that. That's the way I've grown up all my life. Excluding the year of backsliding. So, hey, that's all I know how to do best. That's the best time for creativity. You give God your best. You are committed to it. So you go to bed early. Whether you go to bed 11 o'clock, you still get a 4 or 4:30 or 5 o'clock. You still have to, you discipline yourself. I can rest during the day, but I got to give God. I've got to hear the word of God. I got to get my life in tune for today. How do you worship God? That's what Brother Charles is trying to explain to us here. It's hypocrisy, formality. Lukewarmness, irreverence. We don't reverence God. We don't reverence God. Super Granny called the other day and she was upset. Super Granny is Mama Ola. She was upset. Pastor Williams, some people on the prayer line, they don't have respect for God. They are on the prayer line and they are cracking jokes and they're open. When you open your line for us to pray, they are just talking at the background, and it's true. Irreverence for God. Well, if you don't want to join the prayer line, you know you're in a radio environment, and try to go to a place where you can really hear God, or use a Bluetooth on earphone. Not when we open your line, then you are cracking jokes, saying all kinds of things. Irreverence of God. The other day we had an episode on the line. Pastor Felicia was laying the line. And they said they opened the line for prayer. And yeah, this husband was yelling at his wife on the morning prayer line. And Pastor told me, he says, honey, the guy sounds like you. I said, God forbid. I said, God forbid. He said, honey, for real? So I had to explain to them that it's not you, my husband, because you were sleeping. And the line went off. So the next day, you heard me come on the line. And some of you thought it was me. I said, duh, either your head is somewhere else. How can that be me? When you're on the prayer line, you let your partner know, I'm going on the prayer line. I want to honor God. I want to honor God. I want to reverence this time. I keep on telling you, you can't be afraid of your spouse. If you are afraid of your spouse, that marriage is going to end this year. You go, what? Yes, yes. If there's fear in a marriage, it's not of God. I'm serious about it. If you are fearful of your spouse, oh, he's coming home, what will I do? And you are panicking for a man or for a woman, you're bewitched. You're into witchcraft. And it's going to end. You watch. I said this year is going to be dissolved totally. You watch. You watch. Because it's witchcraft. Fear is not of God. You should be free. You should enjoy your spouse. You should be confident. You should be joy to have them come home. You should be joy to live with them. Fear, anything of fear is not of God. Well, that's a sad track. Let me go back to the word. Irreverence of God. Do you know that God lives in your home? Your home is like a jackass. I agree. Excuse my word. We have children. I agree. Children are dirty. They can mess up the place. Especially if you have a small place. But you try your best. Let God know at least you try your best to clean your best. Try. But the whole place is upside down. There are days the Holy Ghost will wake me up and says, today you're going to take a shower before you're done the prayer line. I go, what, Lord? It's 4 o'clock in the morning. He says, yes, 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 yes. You smell. You go, you know, if you go, what is it? For real. So sometimes when I wake up in the morning, I smell my armpit. Do I have an odor? Is my body odor going to stay the Holy Ghost? You go, oh, Pastor, you're going too far. No, 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 no. Don't think, wait a minute. Am I making sense? Let me hear it from you. Maybe it's only me that does that. Hello, hello, hello. Am I making sense to you this morning? Are you listening? You must reverence God. God is everywhere. God is with you. God is in you. God is by you. Don't assume that God is living in the heavenlies. So the heavenlies is an outer space region. It's a lie. God dwells with you. God lives in you. You go to church on Sunday morning and the church is scattered. The church toiletry is dirty. Take time to clean it. Hey, Pastor, I'm tired. Nobody does it. I keep on doing it. God is going to reward you. God is going to reward you. You're doing the Lord's work. He will reward you. Sometimes we have irreverence for God. The pastor in your church might be preaching, and there you are in the church. You're talking on the cell phone. The pastor is preaching. In the church, you are sending text messages to your friends. Oh, boy, I just bought the new blouse. The color is so brown. I thought, oh, man, I didn't know that was what that blouse was about. I won't have even bought it. You know, okay. I'll try to do something else with that thing now. Okay. You know that, What are you doing? What is up to you? Okay. Why are you going that route in God's presence? It says about our irreverence, our wandering of heart, and forgetfulness of God. What a full measure have we there. We forget God. That's in our public worship now. We forget that we're in the presence of God. Now, it talks about our own work for the Lord, our own work, what we do for God. It's emulation, selfishness, carelessness, slackness, unbelief. What a mass of defilement is there. There are three areas of life you want to check. Your public worship, your work for God, and your private life. What motivates you to do the work of God? For most people, it's money. Oh, I want to be a minister of the gospel, so I will not do work anymore. I will just go to church on Sunday, preach, have a secretary, have a this, and people give their offering, their tithes. After all, pastors in America, they are very well taken care of, prosperity over there. Well, it's true, you can get all those stuff, but don't forget that a day is coming, you will stand before God. If the devil can give you those stuff to win your soul, sorry for you. But that's the state of the church today. Hear me, I'm not saying because of that you're not going to support. No, keep supporting that church and do what you do in that ministry. That's not your business. That is God's business with the person. Can you serve God without selfish agenda, comfort, praise, power? I want to be in charge of this so I can control people, so I can tell people what to do. I want to be in charge of the men's group. I want to be in charge of the women's leader because I'm smart. I'm a wise woman. I can lead women. And Pastor, you know, my position is women leadership. In fact, Pastor Williams, I want to be in charge of the women's group. So no, why don't you want to serve? Why don't you be in charge of the toilet group, the toilet cleaners group? Why don't you be in charge of the usher group, the usher that wait on people to minister? Why don't you serve? Why is it that you always want the one that people will serve you? Selfish agenda. We see that all around in ministry. Whatever motives makes you go into ministry, it will disgrace you. Whatever motives makes you go into ministry, whatever motives draw you into ministry, whatever motives, let me tell you, whatever motive, the motives you have that bring you into ministry, into the work of God, it will find you out. Whatever it is, that reason why you are doing what you are doing, why you are going where you are going, why you behave where you behave, why you do the things you do, whatever is that reason, whatever is that motive, whatever is the logic, the reasoning behind it, it will find you out. So it talks about our work for the Lord. Now, our work for the Lord, carelessness, or you are given a responsibility, and there you are not committed to doing that responsibility with your whole heart. You do the work carelessly. All right, sister, sing for us. Who has a song to sing? You press 5-star. Now you sing. Pastor, I just forgot the lyrics. Then don't press 5-star. You're not ready for it. You must have the book. You must have it. What am I telling you? You must be ready to do the work of God. At your church, you are called to give a message. Okay, Pastor, we do it. You didn't take time to prepare. You were told a week ahead. On the day of preaching, your turn. Well, Pastor, I just forgot. I don't think I'm ready. Can somebody please just help me out? What? You're careless with the things of God. You are careless. Soul winning. Soul winning. Evangelism is still the heartbeat of God. It's not working of miracle. It's not preaching. It didn't say you get reward for preaching. You get reward for winning soul. The Bible says, he that winneth a soul is wise. Well, Pastor Williams, I'm shy. Well, sorry for you because you are shy. The kingdom of God is going to suffer because of you. Pastor, you know, sometimes people will say no. Well, God never told you that everybody is going to say yes. Soul winning. You invite people to the prayer line. It's too early. You keep on inviting them. Okay, go to the YouTube. Watch the videos on YouTube. You still have them? No, make time. Can I call you and share with you what I learned? No, you encourage them. Get them to your home cell group. You invite them to your house for Bible study. You go to when you go visit them, you not visit them to watch movies. I'm not saying it's not fun to watch some good movies that you'll be blessed, but you spend time with the Word of God. Let it has a Bible flair to it. You fellowship. What is your level of commitment to the Word of God? What is your level of commitment to the things of God? That's what he's saying there. Our work for the Lord, it's emulation. You want to copy. We are copying everybody for strife. You want to be like the other person. Your rivalry, selfishness, carelessness, slackness, unbelief. You don't believe that God can make use of you. You don't believe that God wants to use you to achieve great things. You believe for other person, but you don't believe it for yourself. You can let other people be blessed, but you don't believe that you should be doing it. There's this a resonance, unbelief in you. It says, what a shame. What a mass of defilement is there. It talks about our private devotions. Our private devotions, they are laxity. They are laxity. Laxity means conditioned laziness. Without energy, without focus, without vision, that laxity, that way of dullness, no strife, no deeper yearning for God. Pastor, in the fasting and praying, I can't even pray. So during your fasting and praying, you get yourself occupied with so many things. And 3 o'clock, you're joining. You never took time to study in the Word. You never took time to rest in the Word. You never took time to just believe that, to seek God's face, to write down things from God, to meditate on the Word of God. You're just too lazy. Even when it is Sunday, today, you'll still be lazy. That's your private devotion. After the morning prayer, you sleep, you go to church, you come back. Wow, here goes the TV. Here goes the entertainment. Here goes the sport channel. Ah, it's Sunday. After all, my God, you go visit a friend. But with fasting, don't know that. Why don't you do that after the fasting, after 4 o'clock, when you break? Why don't you just spend the rest day in the spirit? After you break, you can go do what you want to do. But your private devotion for God, your private time for God, how well do you use it? That this is a time for God. One thing I admire about my wife is that whenever... it doesn't matter whoever calls. Whenever she comes to the closet and she sees me praying or reading the Bible, she's not going to disturb me. Except it's a life and death thing. And then she will whisper, honey, can I talk to you? Can I talk to you? So when I raise up my head, she sees my countenance. Know that if I'm deep in the spirit or I'm still in the human realm, she will approach. Also with me, when she's praying, I know she's in the private time. I don't care who you are. If you call, you know, I'm the secretary. You can't pass that gate. Because I know she's having a quiet time. Even the children, I don't care whether you want to, you're starving. There's bread there. Go toast that in and eat it. You want mommy? I'll give you the cane if you want mommy. As long as she's busy, she's busy. Your devotion, how deep, how committed are you with God? How serious are you with God? Because it's in the place of that private life that God empowers you. And that's what the prayer ministry is. That's what we do in Wawen. In the morning, we try to develop your private life because this is your private life we are dealing with here. So when people see you outside, they give God glory. Our private devotion, their laxity, coldness, neglect, sleeplessness, and vanity. What a mountain of dead earth is there. yesterday at the prayer study church, those of you that were on the conference line, I know you were blessed. Pastor Sandres is one character of a minister of the gospel. She talked about spiritual obesity. I never heard that term before. It was one that I was blessed. I love listening to her teaching. And she talked about spiritual obesity. She said, just like you see people struggle with food and they are physical obese, so in the spirit, they are spiritually obesity, laxity. Their pastors are afraid to tell them they live in sin. People around them, they are afraid to tell them they live in unholy life, on God. You are afraid to hurt their feelings. I don't want to hurt their feelings. Well, you know, if you wow him, I'm going to hurt your feelings with God's word. As long as it doesn't, if you cross God's word, your feelings will be hurt in this ministry. No apology. Because we're not here to please you. We're here to make you become like God. We want you to become more like Christ in the fullness of God. And she was saying that so many ministers, you live in sin, they pet you. Oh, well, you know, God will give grace. You know, God will empower you. You know, God will do this. Well, the individual is living in sin. One of the partners called me a while ago. He said, Pastor, and she lives upstate in America. And she says, in the northern state. He said, Pastor, my husband, first of all, she called me. She didn't know who I was. She says, Pastor, are you Pastor Williams? I've done your prayer line. Someone give me your number. I'm going through a problem in my marriage. I says, okay. I said, are you ready for the truth? He says, yes, you know, my husband, he doesn't want to do anything. All he wants to do is travel to Africa. Every little time he gets some money, he goes to Africa. And when he goes to Africa, he comes back, he calls me, and I have to do. And she's in the medical field. And he's been in America for years. He has refused to move on with his life. Doesn't have a stable job. I told her. I said, your husband is using you. You have been exploited. And that marriage is not going to work. It's a false marriage. And you have been duped in the marriage. She said, how do you know that? I said, duh. May be asking me how I know that. I said, your husband has girlfriend. He said, yes, yes, yes. Even in this state, so many girls, they call me, we quarrel, we fight, blah, 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 blah. But I have little children. I said, okay, good for you. He said, because that marriage is doomed to fail. That is not a marriage. And she go, how do you know that? That is the truth. Hey, I said, get out of that place. You're being used. He said, well, but my church here, they are telling me, they've been telling me for the past 3 years to hold on. God is going to do something with it. Da, 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 da. I said, well, here we go. See that they don't know what they are doing, or they don't know, have a clue what they are doing. Now you go, but Pastor, can God change it? Well, God can change it, not when the heart of that individual is not born again. Doesn't even care about God. The lady had these four kids by herself, four young kids by herself, and he doesn't care. Goes to Nigeria, stays in Nigeria for 3 months of how many, 8 weeks, then come back again. Then after a while, again, 2 months, goes to Nigeria, you leave her alone with the kids. And you're going back and forth. And she was telling me, I bought diapers, I bought that. When I got home, they disappeared. I said, duh, you don't know what you're doing. What am I saying to you as a church? Sometimes we are pampered in sin. The pastor knows that guy is living a wrongful life. And the pastor is doing nothing. Instead, they are pampering him just to have members. We don't pamper you spiritually. The soul that sinned shall die. That's what the Bible says. If we look more carefully at our lives, if we look more carefully, we should find this iniquity to be far greater than appears at first sight. I want you to look a deeper look at you this year. Your commitment to God, your resolution to God. Yesterday afternoon we were praying, say, God, revive us, revive me. I don't want to be lazy. I've not accomplished anything yet. No, you go, whoa, you go, Pastor Williams. Ah, that is understatement. No, for you, you might think, hey, he has done much. I've not done much. I've not reached my standard yet. Say, boy, why? There's so much. God is great. God is big. You want to relax in just your introduction page of your book, where the book is 5,000 pages, and you are just on page one. You think you've accomplished things spiritually, physically, materially, academically, in every area of your mind. You've not. You shouldn't be spiritually obese. Obesity, so big and so fat in the spirit, you've been fed candy. Pastor Sanders said, the devil gives you candy. She made a very good analogy. She said, if you have a child and the child is crying and the mother is so busy, she doesn't want distraction, she just give me a lollipop. Hey, take, hush. And the baby stop crying because the baby is licking sweet candy. Sweet. The baby doesn't cry anymore. And the mother can do what they want to do. But you thought you've helped that child. But not knowing you've wrecked that child by giving that child candy. Soon that child becomes hyperactive. Haven't you discovered that with your children? They become so hyperactive. Now they need more candy. And so you go to this grocery store, you have chocolate, you have candy, you have it at home. So anytime the child cries, you just fling it. Hey, Bobby. Boop. After that again, he sleeps. He cries. Hey, Bobby. Or if you really want to kill that child, you give that child soda, Coca-Cola, Fanta, Sprite. Oh, yes, you poison that child with those stuff, you know. 1 year old, 2 years old, you have their own bottle. So you open the Coca-Cola, you put it on their feeding bottle. Come on, girl, poison that child now. That's it. That's the way to go. That's the way to go. So that child grows. That child doesn't drink water anymore. Hallelujah for you. When you think you've helped, you think, oh, I've resolved my problems. Now I've shifted and Jane's crying. I don't want her to cry too much. She cries too much, so I don't want that. Not knowing you're making that child an obese child. Obesity. That child becomes fat and floppy. Flat and poppy. Can't do exercise. Let the child run. Spiritual obesity is the same thing. Oh, yes. Some of you will say fast. Fast is your nightmare. You hate it. Whoosh! When you hear that word far, you thought it's going running fast. Why are we fasting again? Or when you hear all night prayer, you get angry. Oh, pray. I'm tired of praying. Dr. Parson, writing to his brother, says, my parish, as well as my heart, very much resembles the garden of the sluggard. And what is worse, I find that very many of my desires for the melioration of both proceed either from pride or vanity or indolence. I look at the weeds which overspread my garden and breathe out an earnest wish that they were eradicated. But why? What prompts this wish? It may be, is saying, it may be that I may walk out and say to myself, in what fine order is my garden kept? This is pride. Or it may be that my neighbors may look over the wall and say, how finely your garden flourishes. This is vanity. Or I may wish for the destruction of the weeds because I'm weary of pulling them up. This is indolence. So that even our desires after holiness may be polluted by ill motives. What is Mr. Parson saying that wrote to his brother? He says, sometimes even when you think you have done all right, you are righteous. Now, congratulations. You are filling the spirit. You want to live a holy life. It can still be done by a wrong motivation. You might still be motivated by pride. I had a man of God, a great man of God, preaching a wonderful message. I personally enjoyed the message of faith. But I began to pray for him. I said, God, I hope this guy is not crossing this threshold. I mean, he's one of my mentors. He's a successful man of God. Great mentors. I love him. I buy his book. I watch his messages. But that message he preached on that particular day, I could discern the way he was preaching, the way he was moving, the way he was hitting the members and touching them to explain a point. And I said, God, I hope this great man of God is not going this route. So I began to pray. Sometimes you check yourself. What about me? I hope I'm not going that route. There's a scripture that I always use as a mirror for myself. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 28. And Jesus says, on that day, many will say, in your name, I've cast out devil. Good. You helped people. Good. In your name, I raised the dead. Oh, good. At least you help someone. In your name, I did miracles and all kinds. Good. And yes, God will say, I don't know you. get behind me. So I always have that scripture in my mind. It's like this two-edged sword that keeps me humble. That is the scripture that keeps me humble. That is the scripture. I've heard that scripture for years, and it's always on my mind. It's always in the back of my mind. After every great service, it's always in the back of my mind. Mr. Parson, writing to his brother, explains pride, vanity, ill motives. Ministers, I talk to you as ministers, and I say it again, let your life be pure, that there's no ill motives in everything you do. Come to that place in your spirit man whereby the things you do for God, there's no false motive behind it. There's nothing false in you. There's no falsehood in you. Whatever it is you're doing, there's nothing false. I want you to come to that realization that there's no falsehood in you, in your work for God, in your work with God, in your passion for Christ, in your commitment to the work of God. Let there be no ill motives in you. Nothing fake, nothing selfish, nothing self-centered. Nothing of your own imagination, your own reasoning, your own attitude, your own functionality, nothing of you, nothing that has to be you involved in it, nothing that has to be you coming out of it. So that God can be glorified. So that God can be praised. So that the name of Christ can be exalted. And the name of Christ can be magnified. The name of Christ can be glorified. The name of Christ can be highly exalted in your life. I wanted to say, how cheering is the thought that when the high priest bore the iniquity of the holy things, he wore upon his brow the words, holiness to the Lord. See, when the high priest took over that iniquity of the holy things, when he takes them off in the tabernacle, upon his brow the words are written, holiness to the Lord. And even so, while Jesus bare our sin, he presents before his Father's face not our unholiness, but his own holiness. Oh, for the grace to view our great high priest by the eye of faith. By the eye of faith. By the eye of faith. God is a covenant God, church. I'm telling you this morning. God is committed to holiness. God will, can, desire, seeks to bless you. God seeks to elevate you. God seeks to bring you to another level of grace, to another level of opportunity, to another level of excellence. God wants you to really have the very best. God wants you to really excel, succeed. God wants you to advance beyond your wildest dream. God wants you to accomplish great and mighty things. It is in God's best interest that you become productive. It is in God's best interest that you become established. It is in God's best interest that you become productive. It is in God's best interest that you are very, very achieving what he wants you to do. God wants to establish you. God wants to establish you. God wants to bless you. God wants to cause you to rule, to reign in life as king. It is God's desire. It is God's motivation. It is God's plan that you excel. God has a covenant with you. It is a covenant that your children can share the benefit of the covenant. Covenant with God is a privilege. So when God gives a covenant with man, he wants your children to benefit from that covenant. He wants your family to be blessed by that covenant. First of all, covenant are an everlasting commitment by God. Covenant is an everlasting commitment by God. Covenant. Let's pray before we continue further. I want you to pray that, Lord, search my heart this season, this year, from today onward. I want holiness to be in me. Holiness unto the Lord. As I embrace your covenant of holiness, your covenant of righteousness, your covenant of peace, holiness unto the Lord. I want you to rededicate your heart to God this morning. Rededicate your vision, your passion, your commission to God. Father, every impure thought that has entered my heart, every thought of impurity, oh my Lord and my rock, every thought of wickedness, search me, my Lord. Search me, oh God, this morning. Let impure thoughts be destroyed. Let them have no part in my life. Every spirit of lukewarmness, sluggishness, that makes me so weak, not committed for soul winning, not interested in reaching out to the lost, not interested in going out to those who are broken hearted. I pray, my Lord and my rock, that you forgive me, Lord. I pray, my Lord and my rock, that you cleanse me. I pray, my Lord and my rock, that you change me. Remove the scale, the veil that has covered me, that has wrapped my hand to become ineffective, to become unmotivated to see the lost saved. I pray, Lord Jesus, I pray, Father God, that you will transfire my life. You will transpire my life, oh God, for your glory. You will transpire me, oh God. Somebody pray with me this morning. Pray with me. 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 That God will cause us to become a different. I want to be a genuine child of God. Filled with the holiness. Walking in the covenant of God. Walking in the covenant of God. Walking in God's mandate. Walking under God's jurisdiction. Under the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to have a holy reverence for the things of God. I want to have a holy reverence for the things of God. I want to have a holy reverence for the things of God. I want to have a holy reverence, a holy commitment to God, a holiness unto God, holiness unto God. That I may live holy. And I might be holy. I might behave in a manner that pleases the Lord, a manner that God is pleased with, a manner that God is excited with, a manner that gives God honor, adoration, and glory, in a manner that praises God like never before. My life, oh God, my world, oh God, my destiny, oh God, my marriage, my children, help me to spend the time that I need to bring them into the work of God's covenant in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. One of my desire is that we'll become a growing home cell machine for Christ. Home cell, where your home becomes a prayer city center point. Your home, your apartment becomes a prayer city center point. Out of your home, we reach out to the community. Out of your home, while we ministry, the prayer line gives birth to prayer city from your home. And we spread out. We spread out. From your home, we spread out. From your home, we reach out. From your home, we impact. From your home, we transform your community. Right from your home. Through technology, we can do live conference in your home. We can come into your home live. And everyone in your home can enjoy a live ministration from me, Pastor Felicia, live from your home, interactive. Yeah, we'll be launching the technology coming next month. Sometime February, we'll be launching that technology out. It's there already. When I tell you to go get it, it's in Walmart. I won't say the name yet. Yo, we get it, you buy it, put it on your TV. And you can watch me live on your TV. God is opening doors for us to accomplish these things. You invite your friends, your family on a particular day. They come to you around, give them good food, good fellowship. And then you put on TV, I'm there, right, live. Fellowshipping, you're asking questions, we're relating. It's time we do the work of God with all our heart, giving God our very best, giving God my very best, giving God the very best I can give to him. Making it real. Making it a reality. Making it an awesome reality for the power of God, for the glory of God, for the wisdom of God. I share this with you. God keeps everlasting covenant. It means when God's into an agreement with you, God does not change. The covenants of God are an everlasting ordinance. And God gave Noah an everlasting covenant. Look at the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 23, verse 5. We're talking about everlasting covenant. I want to tell you that everything you need to be established in life has already been given to you by God. And you don't just say, oh, Pastor, I don't know if I can do this. I don't think I'm able. And no, you don't have to go that route, because where your weakness becomes his strength. It is good that you admit that you can't do it on your own strength. That's the first most important thing you need to know. That God, on my own, I can't do this. But because of the Holy Spirit, because I have the Holy Ghost, because I have the power of the Holy Ghost at work for me, I have the power of God at work, I can do it. I have the Holy Ghost in me. Christ in me, the hope of glory. God is with me. God is in for me. God is enabling me. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Your weakness is God's access point to do great things with your life. Your weakness, be it in ministry, be it in business, be it in career, there's no need for you to be weak anymore, because there's so much knowledge out there for you to succeed and not fail. When one is weak, it means they are short of the knowledge of God. But the Bible says the whole earth will be covered by the knowledge of the word of God as the water covers the seas. Habakkuk 2. As the water covers the sea, the whole earth will be covered with the knowledge of God. And because there's a knowledge of God's covenant over your life, hear me, you are destined to make it on this earth. You are destined to accomplish great and mighty things that you alone can do it, because Christ is in you. You are working for God and with God in that business, in that ministry, in that calling, on that project, on that assignment. I guarantee you will accomplish it. It's guaranteed that you will be a success. So there's no place for hopelessness or laziness or carelessness or indifference. There's no place for that, because you are blessed by God. 2 Samuel 23 verse 5. Although my house be not so with God, yet he had made with me an everlasting covenant. Now, David is talking about his house and all kinds of stuff. And though his house is not too perfect and that, says, but God has made an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things. The covenant of God brings order into your life. When you discover God's covenant for your life, there'll be order in your life. When you begin to walk in the covenants of God, when you take God at his word, the word of God is the seed of God's covenant. Often when I talk about seed, some of you think it's only money, because that's the way church religion has taught you. But the seed, the greatest seed that can turn your life around, is the word of God in you. Jesus made a parable about the sower that wants to sow seed. He says the seed is the word of God. In the new covenant, your seed is the word of God. Your money is your fruit. That's why we say you give your tithe. Your tithe is your fruit. Your first fruit, your first income is your fruit. That's not seed. These are not seeds. You go, what? But my pastor said, No. Jesus did not say that. Money is a fruit. Money is not a seed. Money is the end result. Money is not a seed. If you want money, money is the easiest thing to get. He said, oh, here you go. Have a seed. The word of God, the ability to make wealth. Deuteronomy 8:18. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God that gives you the ability to make wealth. The ability to create riches. The ability to be blessed. It means all you need, first of all, is an ability, the word, the creativity, the seed must be in you, and then the riches will come. Ask any successful businessman, they tell you, the business is the seed. The money that the business generates is the fruit. So you can take all their fruits away, but because they still have the business idea, they will still make money. So year to year, month to month, week on week, day after day, they still make money because they have the seed. So when you hear me talking about money, it's the fruit. When I talk about seed, it's the word of God, the promises of God in you, the word of God you are standing upon, the covenant word of God. When you have the seed of life, of the word of God in you, whatever you sow on the earth will yield harvest. Whatever you put your hand to do will succeed. You hear me? Whatever you put your hand to do, that which you put your hand to do, that which you get involved in, that which you commit yourself to do, you will surely succeed because you are sowing seed. And the seed is the word of God. So God's covenant, when you work on that covenant of God's word, and you take that seed of the word of God and sow it in your life, in your heart, in your understanding, and you apply the word of God into your being, and you live in accordance with the word of God, and you manifest the dimension of faith in that word of God, God will establish you on the earth. And your children will be established after you. Because the seed has been put into them. And that seed is the word of God. It will grow in their lives. Okay. Though my house be not so with God, yet he hath made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things. Every covenant of God is an everlasting covenant. David is dead and long gone, but that covenant that God made with the house of David is still in existence today. That is why you can't touch the Israelites, the Jews. Up to now, there's no country in the world that can defeat Israel. There is no country on earth that can destroy Israel. The Star of David is a covenant, is a sure thing. So we that are spiritual Jews that have been adopted into the commonwealth of Israel, by Jesus Christ, you can touch us. Sorry. You can touch us. We have a covenant with God. 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 It's very important to hear that. Ordered in all things, and sure, covenant don't lie. Covenant is bound to happen, regardless of the economy, regardless of the society, regardless of what country you find yourself. It makes no difference. Covenant will always work. Covenant will always work. Regardless of the weather, for this is all my salvation and all my desire, although he make it not to grow. He's saying, listen, although I have my own desire, my passion, God may not increase my passion, but God is faithful to his covenant. What God has said he will do, that's what God is going to bring about. That's what God will do. That the promise of God will not expire in the name of Jesus in your life. Amen. covenant. Whenever God's covenant is broken, there are consequences on the earth. The reason you find natural disaster, the reason you find ungodliness, you find so many people defeated in life, is because they've broken the covenant. Isaiah 24 verse 5, talk about covenant. Covenant are not meant to be broken. Whenever a covenant is broken, there are consequences for breaking covenant. Isaiah 24 verse 5 tells us the condition of broken covenant on the earth. The earth also is defiled under the inhabitants. The earth also is defiled under the inhabitants thereof, because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, broken the everlasting covenant. The reason you find many people in jeopardy of today's society and life as a whole in a chaotic or chaos is because mankind has broken God's covenant. Mankind has broken the covenant of God. They've changed the ordinances, the laws of God. They've applied various ungodly laws in society. As a result, the earth is defiled. The people of the world, the inhabitants of the earth, were plagued by all kinds of infirmity, all kinds of destruction, because the covenant is broken. So there's waste on the face of the earth. Oh yes, you don't break covenant. You don't break covenant. Covenant is a thing that God has ordained. Covenant is a thing that God has ordained. You don't just say, well, you know, I don't feel like it anymore. I don't want to serve you, God, anymore. Well, you know, no. Covenant is covenant. Just like you don't just wake up in your marriage and your marriage and say, well, I don't want to marry anymore. Now, I'm not talking about in a marriage where there is no unfaithfulness or violence. I mean, the marriage is good. Everybody is well. Everybody obeyed their part of the covenant. Everybody is doing things well. You just wake up and say, well, I don't want anymore. I want to try something else. I need a new wife. I need a new husband. Yeah, I just need somebody new. I've been with you for too long. 50 years now. I want to try something fresh. Well, sorry, it doesn't work like that. You break such covenant, you come under a curse. Likewise, in your work with God, when you enter a covenant with God, you don't just change and say, well, God, you know, God, I don't want to serve you anymore. All right, God, okay, I don't want to be a Christian anymore. I don't want to give my life to you anymore. I take my life back. I want to be my own self. I don't believe in God anymore. I don't believe in God. You don't have a choice. If you become an infidel, you're cut out of God's covenant. There are going to be consequences for that. An infidel is one that doesn't believe in it. There'll be consequences. Destruction will come. Chaos will come. You don't break the covenant of God. Defilement will come. The earth will be laid waste. That was the problem of society today. Mankind have sought itself to be independent of God. But God has an everlasting covenant with you, his children. There's the everlasting covenant of peace. That is why no matter what you go through, you have confidence in the God of peace. Jehovah Shalom. Covenant of peace. Isaiah 54 verse 10. Isaiah 54 verse 10. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee. Oh my God, don't you want to shout on that scripture? It means as long as the earth remains, as long as the moon, the sun, the stars, they obey the covenant work of God, you have been given peace regardless of the challenges you go through. You have been given peace. It means the enemy has no permission to ruin or destroy your life. It is impossible. Why? Because you have the covenant of peace. You have the covenant of peace. You have the covenant of peace. Somebody hear me. Why are you restless? Why are you stressed? It's because you don't know the covenant of peace you have. I am so kind of blandy. Leprozoka banda breka leboboshi. Bakala bro suki la babasa. Pray in the Holy Ghost. I have the covenant of peace. What is frightening you? Pastor, you know, this is happening. I don't know what to do. I don't. Hey. You have a covenant of peace. Hush. Pastor, you don't understand. It's like this. My life. I'm gonna die. This is gonna happen to me. Hush. I feel like slapping you. Hush. You don't know who you are. You have a covenant of peace. One of our daughters in the Lord. I love her so much. She called me 2 days ago. I think 2 days ago. And she was in again in the evening. First of all, her daughter called and said, hey, my mom is getting haywire right now. I want you to pray for my mom. But Pastor Felicia prayed, kept quiet. Then she called Pastor Felicia. She's so bonded to Pastor Felicia. They are so bonded. So she called Pastor Felicia and said, I'm tired. Blah, 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 blah. Blah, blah, blah. Her blood pressure was also very high. I kept quiet. I said, honey, give me the phone. I said, by the way, what's your problem? And she started again. Oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. Oh, I'm waited for too long, pastor. Oh, it's not happening, blah, blah, blah. I looked at her. I said, okay. I said, you know what? Open your Bible to Romans chapter 5. She opened her Bible. I said, now you are going to preach to me. Romans chapter 5. I also want you to read that. It's a very interesting scripture. If you have your Bible on the line, Romans chapter 5, Amplified Bible or Living Bible will be sweet. Or somebody read for me. Romans chapter 5. So I told her, I said, open your Bible to Romans chapter 5. You're going to read the first Bible and you're going to preach to me. So she opened it and she said, well, you know, I'm just tired. The whole ordeal, I've heard that so many times. I said, look at you. You tired. Life is this. I said, do you really have a clue who you are? Then, and I told her the experiences I was going through, not in Pastor Felicia's health, in another area of my life. And boy, she was like, whoa, what? And she goes, I know she's been imagining, and you come every morning, you preach the word, and you're on this deadline and this time frame. I go, so God is always faithful. Because I have a covenant with God, and God is always faithful. God has never ever failed me, not once in my lifetime. So why should I be alarmed? Why, you don't understand. I have a covenant of peace. Nothing troubles me. Ever since I've got the revelation of the word of God, or I've sown the seed of God's word in my heart, nothing troubles me. I can be scared, but I quickly counteract it by the word of God. Say, I rebuke you. No, I ain't going to give in. The word of God speaks. Okay, let's read Romans chapter 5. Before we take your prayer point this morning. Romans chapter 5, read for me, Sister Effie. Yes, Sister Effie, read. King James Version, I needed the Amplifier. Okay, read. Read King James. It's good. Read quickly. Therefore, being justified by faith, you have been just as if. And she gave me revelation. She said justification means just as if. I go, what? Oh, boy. That was, she just blessed me with that. That I can run with that series. Just as if. Therefore, being justified by faith. I never heard that revelation before. She didn't know she was blessing me when I told her. She just go, just as if. And I go, whoa, that is deep. She's good at that. She has all those nuggets of truth but she doesn't know what she's worth. So, you know, she will be there. But now that she has some powerful, she goes, just as if. Justification means just as if. Therefore, being just as if. Read on. You have peace with God. Hey, Makalepo Sukalabaha. Woo! I feel like shouting. I have peace with God. If you have peace with God, then God will give you everything you need in life. Because that's the covenant of peace, an everlasting covenant of peace. Peace is the anchor hold of you being able to receive from God. There's no condemnation. You are not condemned. There's nothing condemning your spirit, your mind. You are not regretting life. You are not... can somebody shout? Just shout. Shout.
Valid option.
God. Boy. I have peace with God. What? I have peace with God. I'm not alarmed. I'm not troubled. Nothing troubles me. Nothing troubles you. This year, you have peace with God. This year, you have peace with God. Till rapture, you have peace with God. Therefore, everything you desire is given to you. It's granted. You are bound to make it. You are bound to succeed. Angels are working for you. Humans are working for you. Resources are coming to you. It may not be showing up now, but you speak the word. You need to go through all those issues so that you become who you are. Get a life, somebody. Read on. You have access to God. You have listen, I don't know. Ministers, I told you are all ministers that join in the weekend. Those of you that come in Saturdays, Sundays, I consider you ministers. And I know you. So when I give ordination, I know who to give. I know you. I have a record of all the logs you join in the weekend. Ministers of the gospel. You have grace. You have grace to accomplish great things. You have grace to be successful in this life. You have grace to make that business work, that ministry work, that marriage work, that church grow. You have access to God. There's no middleman blocking you from God. Read on, sweet. My. You rejoice. Your life is filled with joy. The seed of the word of God produces the fruit of joy. These are the fruit of the spirit. Peace, hope. Galatians says these are the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Why? They are producing you because the word of God is the seed. It germinates from you. Read on, sweet. Not only so. Now you shouted amen before. Now the word tribulation, you don't like that word, right? Oh, God, why did you put that word there? You said put it in somewhere else. Tribulation again? Oh, yes. Tribulation, hardship, difficulties, challenging times. Challenging times. As a Felicia is going through challenging times. Or as a husband, I'm going through challenging times. I've been spoiled by her, hugging, pampering. You can't get that. Now you are very conscious. Your mind is like, oh God, help her. You thought because I pray I'm a quote mighty man of God, tribulation will not come. Get a life. Will you get a life? So I was telling the ladies, not even for the specialist issue, I was telling her my own economical tribulation and all the responsibilities that are due. All the responsibilities that are due that must be met. And she goes, what? When she heard my story, she was like, whoa, for real? I said, for real. But God is faithful. Can somebody shout that word, God is faithful? I want to hear you say it. Can somebody shout, God is faithful? Can you shout, God is faithful? Can you shout it that God is faithful? My God. So what's your issue? What's your issue? Pastor Williams, you know, I don't know what to do. My life is hard. What is hard in your life, my dear? You belong to Jesus. You have a covenant.
covenant of peace. Covenants are not broken by God. You break it, but don't break yours. It's an everlasting thing. God cannot break it. God will not change his mind. You have an everlasting covenant with God for that marriage, for that business, for that church, for that anointing on your life, for that desire, that dream God has given to you. There is an everlasting covenant that no demon, no devil, no soothsayer, no witch doctor, no marine spirit can break. Read on. Knowing that tribulation worketh patient. That's the word. Okay. You go, you have your Bible. I'm going to close on that because I want to pray with some of you. Experience. If you don't have experience with God, you ain't going nowhere. If you don't have an experience with God, you ain't going nowhere. God demands experience. God demands experience. Experience is a very valuable thing. Experience is encrypted knowledge. Oh, you like that? Encrypted knowledge. We shall continue tomorrow. This morning, I want to pray for some of you. This morning, you have a prayer request. You have a question regarding this teaching. Five and the star key. I'm going to begin to pray with you and begin to believe God that God's power and God's glory and God's anointing will begin to work in your life. I got 30 more minutes to pray with you this morning. Those of you in ministry, those of you in vision, those of you, five and the star key, I want to pray with one another. I really want to do that today and spend that time. Open your mind. Begin to pray. Holy Spirit, say after me, Holy Spirit, I thank you for your word of truth. Your word has come into my spirit, man. Your word has entered into my heart, strengthening it to grow in me, strengthening me to be equipped by the prophetic word. Let my word be transformed today by your anointing, by your unctioning, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Begin to talk to God. Begin to talk to God. Begin to appreciate God this morning. You are not a defeated one. You are the overcomer. Because Christ in you is the hope of glory. You see the word hope? Christ in you. The kind of level of Christ in you matters. Do you still have baby Jesus in you? Or you have the roaring lion, the victorious one in you? It depends on which of them you carry. Because Christ in you is the hope of glory. There's a covenant God. We serve a covenant God. It cannot change. Because of that covenant, Jesus died and rose again. Death could not keep him bound because there was a covenant. There was a binding covenant with God. And God wants you to be enriched. And God wants your world to be transformed. And God wants you to be transfixed. And God wants to do great and mighty things for you. God wants to do great and awesome things with your life. God wants to do great and glorious things with your destiny. Hallelujah, somebody. Father, we give you praise. We give you praise. We bless your name. We magnify you, Jehovah. Father God, I bless your name. I bless your name. I bless your name. I bless your name. God of covenant.